Our appointed gospel lesson for today is from the book of John, the 3rd chapter. I will not be reading from that gospel lesson today. I'll be reading from the book of Matthew, chapter 26, a continuous reading about the story of Peter and his response to mercy. The gospel of John is a fantastic lesson. I encourage you to please read that. That is that famous passage of Nicodemus coming to him at night. But let me read to you today from the book of Matthew, chapter 26. Jesus said, and this is, of course, at the Last Supper, "Tonight, every one of you will desert me." The scripture says that when the shepherd is killed, the sheep will be scattered. But after I've been raised from the dead, I will go ahead of you to Galilee, and I will meet you there. Peter boasted, "But Lord, even if everyone else fails you, I will never deny you." Jesus replied, "Peter, the truth is that before this night is over, before the rooster crows, you will deny knowing me 3 times. Peter insisted, "But Lord, I would never do that. Even if I have to die with you, I'll never deny knowing you." And all the other disciples said the same thing. The Gospel of our Lord. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we ask you to continue to bless us this day as we take a look at your Holy Scriptures, this continuing story of Peter, his failures, and his reconciliation to you. We pray that you'd help us in the season of grace and mercy to understand more what it means to be the subject of God's grace and mercy, that our lives might be touched and transformed. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. You're at this time welcome to be seated, and we're so grateful that you're here today, for this is our part 2 of our sermon series about mercy, and we're so grateful that you've decided to join us. For today's lesson is all about God's mercy and our failures. And so for our lesson for today, I would like to take a look at, of all people, Peter. We talked about Peter a couple of weeks ago in the Transfiguration and how much I love Peter because of all people, of all the disciples of Jesus, Peter seems to always be sticking his foot in his mouth or saying the wrong thing. But the reason why Peter always seems to be sticking his foot in his mouth, saying the wrong things or doing the wrong things, is because Peter tries harder than any of the other disciples. And I love Peter because Peter is an example of how we all should be. And so today in our introduction, because we are imperfect people like Peter, living in an imperfect world, we all will have failures in our life. In fact, I promise you this, you will fail today, you will fail tomorrow, you will fail the next day, you will fail every day of this month, you will fail every day the rest of your life. And I'm not trying to depress you, it's just true. And here's the other truth, if you're not failing today, or tomorrow, or the next day, there's probably one or two reasons why you don't fail. One, because you're not being honest with yourself. You have a higher value or view of yourself than maybe you ought to, because probably in everybody else's perspective, you're failing every day. Or two, you're just not doing anything. And if you're not doing anything, actually you really are failing, because you're failing to put to use the gifts that God has given you to be a blessing to the world. Now, when we look at our lesson that we're looking at today from the book of Matthew, we have two different characters in our scripture lesson, two different people and two different responses to the grace and the mercy of God. One is of Judas, who betrayed Jesus. The other is of Peter, who denied Jesus. The sin of each is no better than the other. They both did the same thing. They both betrayed their friend. The difference is how they both responded to the mercy that God wanted to show them. Remember, on the night in which he betrayed, Jesus took bread, dipped it in the wine, and handed it to Judas. It's called the sup. That was often true whenever you gathered together for a Jewish meal, that the host of the meal would take the sup and give it to his most honored friend. Jesus, full well knowing what Judas had done, still was offering his mercy and grace to Judas even after the betrayal. That shows you the type of love and the willingness to forgive that God has for us. But it is interesting to see the different responses of these two men, Peter and Judas. Judas rejected God's mercy and couldn't live with himself, so he killed himself. Peter accepted God's mercy and therefore became the rock upon which Christ's church was built. So let's take a look at the scripture lesson for today and what causes failures in our lives. And the number one thing that we learned from Peter is that we often overestimate our strength. Peter kept saying and denying, I'm not going to do this to you, Jesus. Everybody else might betray you, but I won't. Peter overestimated his strength. We can become overly confident in the abilities that we have, and we need to be aware of thinking that's never going to happen to me. I would never do that, because ultimately none of us are exempt from failures. You know, it reminds me, just kind of a silly story, but about 2 months ago, my wife came home with a car filled with groceries, and I will be frank, I was a little bit of a lazy butt that day, and I didn't want to make about 5 trips from the car into the house, so I grabbed like 10 of those plastic bags and put 10 on one arm and 10 on the next, and I was going to carry them all in, and my wife was saying, that's really stupid, that's really dumb, why are you doing that? I said, I can handle it. And you know, the truth is, I had the strength, but there was a problem here. I didn't count on the strength of the plastic bag. So I'm walking, and all of a sudden, one rips, and all the contents fall. And then it's just like a daisy chain. One falls, and then the next falls, and the next breaks. By the time I was done, 3 or 4 of the bags I was trying to carry in, because I was such a lazy butt and trying to get in the house quicker, they had 3 or 4 bags sitting all with the contents all over the sidewalk. And my wife looks at me and says, I mean, she was actually a little more angry than that. She just kind of shook her head, walked into the house, and slammed the door. I'm like, okay, that was really not a smart thing to do. You see, I'm overestimated my abilities to be able to handle all these bags. It happens. I failed. In those cases, what do we learn from the scriptures? Well, okay, maybe not in terms of my lesson about carrying the bags, but we need to depend upon God. We need to have a little more realistic impression of our abilities, because we don't always have the ability to do the things that we think we do. The second thing we learned from Peter, the second reason is because we fear the disapproval of others. This is true with people pleasers everywhere, and we need a People Pleasers Anonymous, because I am certainly one of those people pleasers, and I am chief. But I was actually told one time by a pastor, and actually one of my internship pastors, he said to me, you know, saying yes to everybody and being a yes person is often actually more selfish than saying no. And I'm like, well, that just doesn't make sense. He said it is. And I'm going to tell you why it's more selfish than saying no. He says, because sometimes you set people up for failure. You say yes to things that you just can't accomplish, the things that you're saying yes to. Or you say yes because you don't want to cause a person grief. He said, but you're being selfish. You actually cause grief when you say yes to things that you know you don't have the ability to deliver on. It is selfish also because the only reason why you're saying yes is because you don't want people to think badly of you. He said, what could be more selfish than that? You say yes because you want to be seen as a nice guy. That's a bad reason to say yes to somebody. And so oftentimes we make decisions based on our fear of disapproval. We make popular decisions because everybody's going to like it. Boy, sounds like politicians, right? But it's not necessarily the right decision to make. We don't hold to our values. We make commitments that we can't meet when we say yes, even though we know we just don't have the time to say or do the things that we say. I try more and more often to say, I'm not sure if I can do it, I will try. Because I don't always know if I can accomplish things people ask me to do. I'm doing better at it, still not perfect. Because I know there are a whole list of people who say, he promised that he would do this for me. And I will confess, probably every person in this congregation at one time or another, I promised to do something for you that I never fulfilled. And so you need to help me as well to be more accountable, to either fulfill the things that I say I'm going to do, or just to say, that two-letter word, no. I just am not capable of doing it right now. We become people pleasers, and we ultimately become cowards when we say yes just because we're afraid of how people will view us. Take a look at the lesson the continuation of this story. Peter followed Jesus at a distance to a courtyard of the high priest's palace. He went in and sat down with the guards to see what was going to happen. And he was sitting in the courtyard, a servant girl came to him and said, "You're with Jesus of Galilee, weren't you?" But there in front of everyone, Peter denied it. "I don't know what you're talking about." Peter made a commitment that he couldn't keep and therefore demonstrated himself to be a coward. So we learned two things so far. We can overestimate our strength and therefore fail. We fear disapproval of others and we say yes to things that we just really maybe shouldn't say yes to. Third thing that we do is we speak without thinking and therefore we fail. We speak impulsively, we speak rashly and thoughtlessly. We are always trying to one-up everybody else. Somebody else says, "I'm going to do this," and we say, "Oh, I'm going to do that too." And next thing you know, we find ourselves making a commitment to doing something that we really didn't want to do. We're only doing it because that person said they were going to do it. And maybe there are certain people in your life that push those buttons. They're always trying to say, "I'm going to do this," and then we try to one-up them. You know, just stop. Let them hang themselves. Stop trying to one-up everybody by trying to do something more. Again, that's true with people pleasers. We hear that somebody else is making a commitment. "Oh, I'm going to go visit such and such." And you know, when somebody says that and I'm a pastor and I haven't gone to visit that person, I start feeling guilty like I should have maybe. Well, if you're going to go visit that person, good for you. That's your job. Because we're all called to visit and call and care for people. And if you are going to visit and call somebody, all the better, because then I can take my time and spend it somewhere else. Because you are, on behalf of Jesus Christ, on behalf of this church, going and calling and caring for somebody. Do you see how that works? We often speak without thinking, but oftentimes I'd feel guilty if somebody said, "Oh, I'm going to visit such and such. I just called such and such." I said, "Oh, I better go call and visit them." When I really know it's not a major priority. You've already done it. And I'm grateful for it. We need to stop speaking impulsively and so rashly and thoughtlessly. Ultimately, what happens when we do, we cause a tremendous amount of damage. And so we need to stop before we open our mouth and pause to consider the words that we speak. Boy, I'll tell you what, Facebook is sure open and ripe for that. You know, somebody says something nasty, and somebody says it in response without thinking, and then somebody else does it in response again, and you just get this nasty chain of responses from one person to the next. Nobody's stopping to think, maybe I shouldn't air my dirty laundry to begin with. That might have been a better decision. We need to stop speaking so impulsively. So here I'm going to tell you, and I mention this because we do have a lot of people on Facebook, and I tell you, I love our members, but I tell you, I see a lot of really, really not thought through things that people put on Facebook that they really ought not to put there. If you sit there and you think, "I'm not sure if I should say this, but boy, I'm really mad," maybe you should sit on that for a day and rethink whether you should post that. If you're thinking about sending a text to somebody that's rash and telling them off, maybe you ought to sit and think about it first. If you're thinking about picking up a phone and telling somebody a piece of your mind, maybe you ought to stop and think about it first. Is this really the best thing? Maybe it feels like a good thing right now, but tomorrow, is it still going to feel like a good thing? Maybe we need to stop and think before we open our mouth. Going on in our continuation of this lesson, Peter went out to the entrance of the courtyard, and there a woman saw him and said to those standing there, "This man was with Jesus of Nazareth." Peter denied it. This time he swore an oath and said, "I don't even know that man." But after a while, the men who were standing there came over to Peter and said, "We know that you are the one of them, because you're a Galilean and your accent gives you away." Peter lost his temper and started cursing and swearing, and he shouted, "I don't know the man." And immediately, the rooster crowed. You see what happens when we open our mouth without thinking about what we're saying? We tend to lie. We say dumb things, foolish things, things that get us into trouble, things that betray our friends and our character. We do fail. It happens every day, if you're trying to live your life. And so here's what we need to do when we fail. The first thing we need to do is grieve. St. Peter in Matthew chapter 26, when he heard the rooster crowed, he remembered what Jesus said. Before the rooster crows, you'll deny me three times. And so Peter went outside and wept bitterly. Don't minimize your failures or try to justify your failures with excuses. You failed. It happens. Grieve about it. Be sorrowful. Shed tears. Because that's the only way you're going to receive healing. To get past your failures, we need to go through them. And see, Peter, God bless him, unlike Judas, Peter owned up to his failures. He wept. He spared his life. It gave him the opportunity to hear from God's mercy. I just want to tell a story and weave my story into these last three points here, a few points here. I have told once before the story about how my very first internship, see, in seminary, we Lutheran pastors go to 4 years of schooling to work to get our master's degree. We have an internship for a year. We're serving as an intern pastor, a vicar, in a parish for a year. I actually went to two internships because, boy, I'm special. My very first internship was a church. I was in Minnesota, and I wanted to stay close to the seminary and St. Paul because I was training and hoping to qualify for the 1988 Olympic trials and the steeplechase, and I wanted to stay by my coach. But the only internship church they had was a parish that had 17 interns prior to me. Every single one of those interns failed. But I was really young and naive, and I believed that I could do anything, and so I said, I'll take it. And so this parish, when I went over there, they told me, well, we want you to do the youth group. Now, here's the understanding. I was an intern, but I was a part-time intern. What I was doing was called a concurrent internship, where I go to the seminary half-time and go to the serve in the parish half-time. And so here's what they were telling me. We want you to do the youth group. Sounds great. Love it. We want you to do our social ministry committee. Awesome. We want you to also do our evangelism committee. Great. We want you to do all the visitation because the pastor really doesn't like to visit. Awesome. We want you to teach the catechism class because the pastor doesn't like to teach catechism. Awesome. We want you to preach every other Sunday because the pastor doesn't like to preach every Sunday. And great. You know, you're only supposed to preach once a month as a full-time intern. I heard this is great. I was going to get to preach a whole lot more than any of my classmates. Awesome. Oh, by the way, we're doing a building program. We want you to be a part of the building program. Awesome. So I said yes to a whole bunch of things that I just didn't have the ability to deliver. Number one, because I had no clue how a committee ran. Secondly, I didn't know how to do any of this stuff. Thirdly, it was more than one full-time pastor can handle, let alone a part-time intern. Needless to say, at the end of 6 to 8 months, I think it was. I don't remember how long it was. It was around Easter time, Lenten time, when we were doing a moderately operating social ministry thing that was going on in the church. I think a dinner for a Lenten service. It wasn't going too well, but we had maybe 50 people there. And the president of the congregation was really upset with me because I wasn't getting done everything that I needed to get done. And so she came over and backed me up in the corner. I mean, this is a little tiny woman. She was maybe 5'2", and she has me backed up in the corner, poking my chest and saying, you know what? The pastor's stressed out, and when he's stressed out, I'm stressed out. You're not getting the things done, and therefore the pastor's stressed out with you. And if the pastor's stressed out with you, I'm stressed out with you. And by the way, this is coming up till Easter time and Good Friday, and if this were Easter 2,000 years ago, there'd be a fourth cross on the lawn, and you'd be on it. I'm like, okay. It was a bad situation. I thought I was being treated unfairly. In one sense, it's probably true. This church was way over optimistic about what an intern should accomplish, as evidenced by the fact that 17 interns had been in this parish before me, and every single one of them had failed. But regardless of this, I got taken out of this place and out of this church. And I thought, all I need to do is get out of this church because they were a bad church. Awful people. Can't believe the way they treated me. Oh, poor me. But at some point in my grieving process, I had to come to the realization I had a problem too. Because you know, when they were sitting there and asking me about all these things I was supposed to do as an intern, I said, yes, I can do that, I can do that, I can do that, I can do that. I never said, what's that two-letter word again? No. Now, you could say I was a young person, I shouldn't have had to say no, and maybe all that's kind of true in one sense. But you know, I could have said no to the site. I could have rejected the site. I didn't, because I wanted to be perceived as a good guy. I could do it. So grief ultimately had to lead me to the point where I realized it wasn't them. Yes, what they were asking me was unfair, but I wasn't realistic about my abilities. I'll be frank with you, it was for the very first time I had to sit and question whether or not I was cut out to be a pastor. It was not an easy conversation with God and with myself. I'd spent, by this point, 6-7 years in school to be a pastor, and you spent all this money, and I wasn't even sure if I was going to now be a pastor. You talk about grief, but it was important for me to go through that in order to receive God's healing. So this brings up number two. When we've gone through this grieving process after our failure, we need to let other people support us. You need to resist the urge to isolate yourself and insulate yourself from other people, because we need godly support and goodly support and kindly support more than any other time in our life after we've failed. But yet, oftentimes, it's the one thing we don't want because we're embarrassed. We don't want to be around people. But that's what you really need. People are going to care for you. And in my case, my failed internship, I was forced by the man named Randy, who was my supervisor at that time, my internship supervisor. Randy made me go and get counseling. Like there was something wrong with me, you know? I didn't fail. It was all these people at this church. They failed me. But I am so grateful. I had this wonderful woman named Helen Harms. I went to her every week for that entire next year while I was working and finishing up my educational aspect and preparing to go for another internship. And I tell you what, she was just dynamite. She made me look at a lot of things in my life that God needed to bring healing to those things. I needed her support. Didn't want her support, didn't want to be there. But of all the things that happened in seminary, that was probably the most important thing. And I'm so grateful to Helen this day for the gift that she gave me and the support that she provided me in my time of need. Number three thing that we need to do when we fail is we need to cast ourselves on God's mercy and understand that our failures do not need define who we are. Here's what Satan wants you to do after a failure. Satan whispers in your ear, you're just not good enough. See, I told you you're a failure, you're no good. There's no way that God could ever use you again after what you've done. And you keep repeating that message in your ear over and over and over, over and over again. You are doing the devil's work for him. But that's not how God responds to our failures. God doesn't sit there and say, I can't believe what a foolish person you are. Here's what God does. In God's eyes, for those who fail, there's no condemnation. In fact, let's take a look at this. Turn over to the next page. This is what Jesus does for you when you fail. God knows that you're going to fail. You fail on a regular basis. You fail every single day. It happens. God is not sitting there in judgment saying, I can't believe you. God helps pick you up and dust you off and says, that's just a part of growing. Do you realize that failure is just a part of the growing process of this life? We need to fail in order to learn and grow. It's a part of our life. Embrace the fact that when you fail, it hurts, you grieve it, you learn something about yourself, you get better. How amazing is that? Look at what Jesus said to Peter. Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to sift you like wheat, but I prayed for you that your faith should not fail, so that when you've repented and you turn back to me, you will strengthen and build up your brothers in Christ. So here's the thing. When we fail, when we make a mistake, when we say things that we shouldn't, when we do things that we shouldn't, God's not shocked. God knows that we're going to make mistakes. God made us. God didn't make mistakes in us, but God made us to grow and learn. And sometimes in the growing and learning process, we are going to fail and make mistakes. It just happens. So he's not shocked by it. He doesn't get angry at us by it. In fact, on the contrary, what Jesus does for Peter is he prays for him. He says, I'm going to pray for you that you grow. And then, amazingly, number three, he believes in us. Because he knows we can do better. We will continue to grow and do better. So God always is the eternal optimist, knowing that we will improve and get better in our lives. And isn't it awesome to have that wonderful God in your corner supporting you? Number four thing God does for us, he shows us his mercy when you're down. And number five, he uses our failures to build up his church. So nothing is ever wasted. We fail, but that's an opportunity to help somebody else when they too have failed, that we can reach down and pick them up. You know, one of the things I notice as you get older, you look at 20-year-olds and you're saying, oh, you know, you automatically think, oh, they're being really foolish. I can't believe they're going to do that. But what we have to do is step back and let them fail. How are they going to learn if we don't